Would you eat a piece of beef that didn't come from a cow? When I scroll through my Facebook feed, I see a lot of people talking about food. Not a big surprise, I got a couple of vegans on there, one paleo, gluten-free. I got an organic locavore, and there's a guy who apparently only eats cabbage and lemons when Saturn's in retrograde. Look, it's not a big surprise that we all like to talk about our diet philosophy. I mean, food is health, food is culture. Food is really all about the history of us as a species. I mean, it literally becomes who we are. About 10 to 12,000 years ago, our ancestors kicked off the most novel enterprise in human history, agriculture. By transforming their environments and domesticating food crops, these proto-farmers were actually able to provide a little food security. And with that food security, we could build cities. Heck, we could even build empires. Beyond that, we also developed things like the written word and literature, math, and science. In fact, you could say that all of human civilization was created by changes in the way we satisfy our hunger. And you know, food sciences change pretty quickly. In fact, so quickly that it's difficult to keep up with. Today's transgenic crops are genetically modified for all kinds of purposes. Some resist herbicides, some repel parasites, and some contain nutrients not found in the naturally occurring strain of the plant. Agricultural robotics is also a booming area of research. Prototype ag robots can spray pesticides, they can plant seeds, they can even fertilize field soil. Now, the next step will be to develop harvester bots that will actually be able to tell when a fruit is ripe and will be gentle enough to pluck something as delicate as a tomato or strawberry without damaging it. Food production is already borderline science fiction, but what kind of stuff is actually going to end up on your plate in the future? Well, how about a beef patty that's never seen the inside of a cow? You see, meat, especially beef, is environmentally unsustainable. It has a huge carbon footprint. So if we could find a way of reducing that, that would be excellent, right? What if we could just grow it? In August 2013, the world's first lab-grown meat, called in vitro beef, was served in London. It was actually created by a biopsy of stem cells from living animals. Now, this particular hamburger cost a mere $300,000, and they didn't even supersize it. But it's just a first step that could pay off in the long run, and not just with animal rights. A study in 2011 showed that lab-grown meat could have 96% fewer greenhouse gas emissions than conventionally grown European beef. Of course, there's another potential solution to the meat problem if we're a little flexible on how many legs our meat has. For example, insects like caterpillars and locusts might not seem appetizing to those of us raised on a Western diet, but they're chock full of protein, and cultures around the world have been enjoying them for centuries. This solves a lot of problems, too. We don't have to worry about sustainability, and there's no shortage of natural supply. Entomologists estimate that there are 200 million insects per person on Earth. So I have a question for you. Which would you eat first? Lab-grown beef? Or an insect burger? Let us know in the comments below, and if you enjoyed this episode, make sure you like it and subscribe to our channel to watch lots more videos about the future really soon.